Hi, Detoxers. Laura Foster back here today. And today I have an awesome guest with me. If you have been paying attention in your sugar detox and you've been doing your homework and you've been watching the videos, then this person's not new to you, but this is new content because today we're going to be talking about some add-ons, some leveraging, some next steps. And I think it's really, I think you're going to find a lot of great value from this. I am not actually going to introduce her. I'm going to let her introduce her. So without further ado, welcome Dr. Heather Denniston.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for joining me.
It's such an honor to be here. And as you know, Dr. Laura, I've not only spoken for you before, but I've been through the course a couple times actually, and absolutely love it. So I am super happy to be here with the other detoxers and just sharing some of the information and expertise that I have. And so I'll just very briefly, I am also a chiropractor like Dr. Laura. I think we're at 21 years, 22 years, somewhere in there. And I left the brick and mortar space a while ago to move into the online space with my company, WellFit and Fed. And that broke off into three tangents. I have a wellness strategy work that I do with small corporations. I have a Junk You Should Know show that I produce and air on Facebook Fridays at noon.
Which you need to repeat because I have been sharing this for how long now? The Junk You Should Know show is on. I'm just slowing this down because I know you. You're so humble and you're just going to go zooming right by this. So like, slow it down, Dr. Okay. Heather.
Okay.
The Junk You Should Know show is really the Good Stuff You Should Know show. And it's every Friday at noon Pacific Standard Time.
Correct.
On the Well Fit and Fed. And we'll put all this stuff in the show notes. The Well Fit and Fed Facebook page, correct? That's how you go in. You can watch it live or you can go back in and look at the replay.
Yeah, you can. And replays are always on the Well Fit and Fed YouTube page. So you can check it out in a couple places. And then number three, I run an online membership called The Change Cave, which is to inspire and ignite first steps in women over 40 to up their wellness game. And so that's where I'm finding myself. And I have my chiropractic degree, but I also have a chiropractic certification wellness practitioner thing, and it's just a little extra education in fitness and nutrition and mindfulness and wellness. And then I thought, well, I was teaching fitness and exercise, and a lot of people don't understand that chiropractors know how to do that. So I thought, well, I'll get my NASM certified trainer as well, so that's there if anybody has a question. So that's what we're talking about today, right, Laura? We're going to be getting into some movement and some exercise, and that is my area of passion for sure.
Yeah. I mean, this is the one thing that we don't do a fantastic job. As you know, at this part in the program, a lot of the people have definitely really understood the part about the sugar detox. They're now, for the most part, they're really integrating the day in, day out, low sugar, whole food lifestyle. And there's still some questions coming up. And every time I run the program, we start talking about this at the end of the program. Most people have lost some weight. Most people, if not on the scale, they feel, you know, leaner, they feel slimmer, they feel stronger, their digestion's better, they're sleeping better, they feel more connected, they feel more in control. And really in control, but also they understand a little bit more about what their tendencies are and how to work with that. But the things that keep coming up for some people are, how do I use a low sugar, whole food lifestyle, a very fat adapted program to perhaps lose more weight? If you're one of those people where, you know, the number's bigger and you need to have an enhanced strategy, we're going to talk a little bit about this. This is where some more information about the Change Cave, which you'll find in the body of this email, really comes into play as well. But then also there's the people where, you know, I want to now start moving my body. I can take the techniques and a lot of the mindset and heart set of this program, and I want to leverage it. I want to move more. I want to be able to exercise better. I want to set some goals for myself, but either they get set back by injuries. You know, you have some personal experience around this, Heather. Can you kind of just enlighten us so people know that you're not just coming from an academic background?
Yeah, for sure. When I was young, I was largely left to my own devices. I had a mother who was kind of done raising children, and my sisters were much older than I was. My dad traveled a lot. And I didn't realize it at the time, but I found friendship in food, and primarily junk food and the high sugar kind. I'm not talking like some nice dark chocolate. I'm talking like Sour Patch, gummy bear, licorice, that kind of stuff. So we're talking just packed full of those grams of sugar, which you guys all know what that does to your brain and body now. And I would ride down to the store and buy $10 of junk food, which in 1975 was a lot of money. And I'd come back. I literally would hide out in my closet and binge eat. I was a closet binger before there was a name for it. And I was eating thousands of calories, probably over what I should, but I was a competitive gymnast, so nobody noticed. And then I started growing like a mastiff puppy, and mastiff puppies don't do back handsprings on the beam. So I quit gymnastics. And at that time, I went off to a boarding school, which was an incredible opportunity, but very unpoliced in regard to your eating, your snacking. And so my behaviors just continued because I didn't know better. And I came back, and when I entered college, I was about 175 pounds, probably 25 pounds overweight. And by the end of about 12 to 18 months into my college experience, I pushed over 230. And the thing was, Laura, is I was exercising. I was practicing some of the latest diets and all those. It was not for lack of trying, but I could not turn it around. And that's when I really got serious. It happened to dovetail with when I went off to chiropractic school. I met people like yourself who were already a little ahead of me on the journey as far as figuring out nutrition and fitness. And I just became a sponge, both professionally and personally. And I've made it a lifetime of learning what works for me personally, and then professionally what works for my patients and clients. And so that's where I'm coming from. It's, you know, it's hard sometimes when they see us from the shoulders up and they look at the list of credentials and stuff, it's hard to go, well, how do you know where I'm at? And yeah, I do know where you're at. I've been there. So I get that whole idea of either not moving, not exercising, or not knowing how to do it correctly for the goals you have in mind.
There is nothing more frustrating than just truly knowing what you want and actively working at it, but having maybe the wrong information, or you're just like that 5% off the target. And over time, it's just not getting you to where you want to go. I just, my heart bleeds when I hear that.
Yeah.
I mean, it's true. I think it's always good to mention that when you're looking in on somebody else, you're seeing where they are in that moment. And it's hard to have that perspective. So thank you for sharing that.
Yeah.
So lots of stuff that we're going to kind of cover today. So the first thing I would say is, you know, let's talk about the weight loss. You know, for those people who are on their detox journey, what would you even advise from where they are right now? Do you have some thoughts around that?
I do. And this has come from recent practice, actually, just over the last couple of years. And the first is identifying your wellness why. And that is understanding deeply to the point it moves you even to tears, understanding why do you want to be well. And that's a process of continuing to ask yourself why. So if you first say, well, I want to be well because I want to be healthy when I get older, but why? Well, because I want to be active. Why? And you keep digging down deeper until you find that deep moving piece that's going to get you out of bed and to the gym at 6 a.m. And so identifying that, putting it up around your house or in your car, and just so you can return back to that when you're feeling discouraged about, you know, that deep moving why you're doing this is important. And number two, I think it's identifying what I call a PIP, a personal improvement plan. And that is, we are projects and we need to be our own project manager. And so that means we need to hire a team. And so you guys have already done great in hiring Dr. Laura to coach you through the food, the sugar, all of that. But perhaps you need a trainer or a physical therapist or a homeopath or a psychologist. Putting together very intentionally a personal improvement plan that includes your personal improvement team, I think is super essential as well. And I think too, just making sure you're tapping into your resources and identifying and sticking with a particular resource for a longer time. I know a lot of people do one particular thing for a short time and then they kind of jump around a little bit. A lot of this stuff takes long work, patience, and perseverance. And that's where the team can be very supportive for that.
Yeah, I don't disagree with you. I mean, we do share some very similar ideas and values on this, but I really I just feel like you're able to kind of tap into this a little bit more. I think it comes from working more specifically with people, but it's true. I mean, if you don't know what your why is,
yeah,
at a core level, there are going to be so many things. It'll be like those, you know, those like toys that are like heavy on the bottom. This is not a very good explanation. And they're like, they're those wooden dolls and yes. You kind of hit them and they bobble back and forth.
Yeah.
That's what's happened to me when I haven't been clear about my foundational why.
Yeah.
You know, in January in Canada, you do not want to get out of bed at 5 o'clock. And this isn't all about getting out of bed at 5 o'clock.
No, exactly.
But being very connected to that, I think, is really important. So now we talk a lot about exercise. People have a real aversion to the word exercise, but there's also times when you and I will use the word, and I hear you speak of the word movement. What's the difference between movement and exercise?
Yeah, I love that question because I would say most don't identify them as two different things. And so exercise, just put simply, is targeted to build speed, build agility. It can include weights or cardio or any kind of workout that brings an intensity to it that accelerates heart rate, probably makes you kind of sweaty, might even make you sore the next day. That's what actual exercise is. And then movement is a whole different thing. And I'm going to use an example. Do you know who Dr. Joanne Vernikos is, Laura?
I do not.
Of course you don't, because she's been hiding out in a NASA lab for 30 years. And she only just recently figured out something kind of interesting. Her whole job has been to work with astronauts coming back from space and their subsequent health problems, because they have a lot. Diabetes, cancers, back pain, cognitive issues, so many different things that are sort of unusual. We weren't really understanding why this was. So it was her job to research it. Well, along the way, she found another population that suffers these exact same early onset conditions. And it's people who also defy gravity, and it's those of us that sit for a living. Mm-hmm. And so the concept was, it is sitting, but it's the lack of movement. And movement is identified as anything other than sitting or lying down is movement. Getting up and walking around, a little bit of stretching, dancing around a little bit, walking a little extra distance from the parking lot, taking the stairs. These are things that are movement. And she, as a very, very bright scientist, said, this is actually, in the end, more important than exercise. Getting enough physical movements so our bodies are working against gravity, which they are naturally intended to do for so many reasons, is of absolute importance for our wellness. So things like, people are so surprised to hear that those that are sedentary sit for more than only 2 hours a day, which many of us do. Yeah. It's not 9 hours a day or 14 hours. It's just a few hours a day puts you into this category of cognitive changes, early onset dementia, higher risk of Alzheimer's, diabetes, different cancers, obviously back pain. That just goes without saying. And weight gain, of course, right? And so the idea that she wrote a whole book called Sitting Kills, which is kind of an interesting title, but her book is great. It's a thin little book called Sitting Kills, and it talks about the idea of movement and getting up and getting more numbers of movement, steps, you know, different things that your body is doing, putting yourself through ranges of motion than you're used to, and really focusing on that, not just getting to the gym for half an hour. And so I think that's where you were asking as far as movement versus exercise and how movement can play a role in those of us who are not only trying to lose weight, but who want to stay cognitively alert, who want to stay just healthy in general. From a physiologic standpoint, movement's essential.
It's true. And it's like one of those things where you can turn the dial pretty easily. If you know, don't get me wrong, there is a very important part of our lifestyle that I think should always include exercise.
Yes.
But at the very least, at your foundation, at your core, yeah, if you can just start to integrate more of this idea of movement, it also takes that edge away for people who are always feeling like they can't quite get on top of it. It's just, yeah, like the question then becomes like, how do I incorporate more movement? What can I do, yeah, more of? You know, we're looking for small incremental changes where you start, yes, to have the success, right?
Yeah. And one of the easiest ones with that, Laura, is anyone who's in this program who sits is moving to a standing station or a bouncy ball or a sitting disc or setting a timer to get up and do jumping jacks or bend over and touch your toes. There's so many things that you can do. Like I said, parking further away from the entrance. It's stuff we inherently know, but we only now realize the science connection and the the detrimental health effects that this sitting and sedentary business has on us.
For sure. So I think that's, you know, I love that we talk about that. We very consciously decide to talk about this. And yes. I talk about it in my foundations program because I think it's foundational, right?
Yeah.
This is where it starts. And if you think about this every single day, I'm getting on a plane tonight. I'm going to be on a plane for hours and hours and hours. So today I am moving my booty wherever you go. I didn't go to the gym. I didn't get a chance to go to yoga, but I'm thinking, where can I get more movement in?
Yeah.
And I've seen tons of videos with you. You're on a yes. park bench, or you are, you know, doing step ups at the airport. She's the crazy girl doing step ups at the airport. Yeah. You have lots of videos that are just short in short ways to increase your intensity and get your movement in. So I, you know, again, going back to a lot of your resources,
yeah.
I think we should utilize that. So I'm going to point people back there.
Great. And I'll just bring up the other day, I had an appointment. I ran out of time. Like, you didn't have time to go to the gym. I was able to walk to the appointment. I just took my jump rope. I had 6 minutes to spare, and I kid you not, 6 minutes. So I found a piece of concrete I could just do some quick jump rope on. I went as hard as I could for 6 minutes, and I was wiped. Like, I was sweaty and heart rate and the whole deal. And it was 6 minutes.
Yeah.
And there's one particular blog post I want to direct people to, and that is the five-minute workouts for every room in your house. You can find that on the WellFit and Fed blog. And that's a great place to start because it gives you five different, just 5 minute workouts for the bedroom, the kitchen, the living room, the stairs, the backyard. And so that there's no excuse, right? I mean, you can absolutely, and it's no equipment. So there's just things you can do to get yourself moving.
Yeah. Fantastic. Okay. So I'm going to do a 180 here.
Okay.
Okay. So, I will often hear things people will say, what is it? Oh my gosh, I'm going to totally ruin this one. You know what? I probably shouldn't even go there. I always try and say, so let's talk about, you can't outrun your fork. How would I just go there?
Okay. So that's a saying I heard a long time ago. I like that you said that. You can't outrun your fork. At first, I didn't really know what it meant. And then I'm like, oh my gosh, that is such a huge statement and people might gloss over it. But there's a few points here I want to bring up with that saying. And it really dovetails nicely with the detoxers because your program, I don't care how much you're working out and exercising, if you are not owning it in the kitchen, you're not going to make your health goals. You're not going to make your weight goals. It's just not going to happen. That's what it means by you can't outrun your fork. And also another thing that people do is this one-to-one, like, oh, I did 350 calories mm-hmm. on the elliptical. I can have an extra cookie. People, please don't do that to yourself. Okay. You're sabotaging yourself immediately. Unless you're an ultra marathoner or you are going to do an Ironman, we do not ramp up our calories because of exercise. Okay. You'll make up for it. Trust me. You'll have a day in a couple days forward where you overeat mm-hmm. or you know, and so that idea of, oh, I'm going to put it in my MyFitnessPal and see how many extra calories I can eat today. Please absolutely do not do that to yourself. Leave your activity off my fitness app, or at least do not count the burned calories. Also, because unless you're wearing a heart rate monitor, it's inaccurate anyway.
Right.
So that's important to know that what your elliptical is telling you is highly inflated because your gym wants you to come back and burn more calories. And so they do. I'm not kidding. They've done where the heart rate monitor versus actual readout is very, very different.
Oh my gosh. I have to just say that's so true, but I'm like, I totally fell for that. And I'm the person who always reads the ingredients, reads the fine print on things like that. Yeah. I never even thought of that, but that's true. It's great to track things because it increases your level of educational awareness, but exercising or moving so that you can turn around and eat, it's sort of it's a backwards thinking.
Yeah. And I want to say you trained for an Ironman. I'm sure you were looking to get some extra calories for your workouts, and that makes absolute sense. But if you hit the gym 3 times a week or maybe a yoga class a couple times, you don't need to enter into that science of you know, making sure you're balancing one side to the other. So I think that's really important in regard to you can't outrun your fork, because I have too many clients that are like, I'm doing the workouts, I'm eating well, and it's just a matter of, well, they've been kind of borrowing from Peter to pay Paul, and we don't really understand how those calories are used in our body anyway. It is still not a one-to-one, even if you know that. But yeah. So I think that's really important to understand is, as you guys are starting to up your exercise and up your movement, don't use it as a license to have a free for all. I know you're still going to stay low sugar, but yeah. we still have to utilize those calories, and so we don't want to overdo it.
Well, and let's be real. A low sugar whole food lifestyle can still be high calorie if you're not careful.
Absolutely.
You know, there's things that are, I mean, fat for one is high in calories, and again, yeah. a calorie is not a calorie is a calorie. So we're not saying. Yeah. You know, and you can dive into that a little bit more, but at the same time, just being aware that, you know, if you keep adding tremendous amounts of fat into your diet because you've heard that you want to be fat adapted and this keto yeah. word has come by your consciousness, just recognize that some of yes. those things, if you're using them improperly, can actually get you the results that you're not looking for. So tell me about the calories, not a calorie.
Okay, I will. But on that, because you just brought up such a good point, and that is that your body's highly efficient. If you feed it too much calories, it has this incredible storage system that it's going to utilize because it thinks it might need it later. And that's our saddlebags and our muffin top and all of that. So it will make very good use of it. It's just, if it's floating around there for a while, your body's going to put it away. And so I like that you mentioned that about a lot of people switching over to keto are like, why aren't I losing weight?
Yeah.
Okay. So I am not a, I don't dive heavy into this because I think it's important not to hyper-focus on fat, protein, carbohydrates, all of that, in my opinion. But I think we need to understand that fat calories are just worth more energy. So when you eat an avocado, there's more energy in an avocado than the equivalent, you know, protein or carbohydrates. So we need to understand that, number one. And we need to know that carbohydrates, speaking to the choir, are utilized. I mean, that your body just says sugar. And so it converts it in such a way that is less efficient and useful for your body. And so focusing on the fats and the proteins, which is what you encourage, and really healthy, fibrous, high nutrient dense carbohydrate, is the direction you want to go for sure. So I hope I answered your question.
You totally answered my question. We could probably go on. We both of us geek out about this topic all the time. So yeah. So going back to a little bit about helping people on this program achieve their goals, we're going to talk about setbacks in a few minutes. We're yeah. going to talk about how do you exercise and how do you create more movement if you don't have great mobility, because I know yes. that's a concern for some people. Yeah. You're going to give us some tips on some resources that you think are amazing. So you train a lot of people and you train yourself. You're very good about having a training program for yourself. What are some of the key elements you work with when you're training somebody yeah. to achieve their goals?
Well, I never sugarcoat it. It's putting fitness is actually, it's simple. There are some simple rules. It's just not easy. It does take effort, and it's even me who is, I love working out. I love getting up and getting to the gym. There are days it's an effort, but when you're able to go back to your wellness why and go, I'm going to do it anyway. Because I believe so strongly in this wellness why, that helps get you through it. So don't fool yourself that suddenly it's just going to become easy. It's not super easy for me. It's not easy for Dr. Laura. We still have to work at it, but we prioritize it to the point that it's a non-negotiable appointment in our calendar. Mm-hmm. And that's a big thing too, is I, particularly the women out there who tend to put themselves kind of behind their children and behind school activities and behind all these things, telling them to put it first in their calendar. That's a hard shift to make. But if you don't do that, it won't be a sustainable process in your life. And I think it's really important to consider, you know, you'd never cancel on the most important client that you have, the most important friend who needed you, but yet we cancel on ourselves for workouts all the time. And I think it's important to make that paradigm shift and say, no, this is the most important appointment in my schedule. Because if I'm not healthy and I don't stimulate my brain with exercise, I can't be there for my family or my work. So I think non-negotiable appointment, simple but not easy. Start with one small change. So too many times someone's come to me after failing. And it's because, okay, I'm going to join CrossFit after not having done anything. And I'm going to go 6 days a week. And I'm going to get injured and then quit. And that's what happens over and over again. So you're in this for the long game, guys. start with something very simple, maybe one yoga class a week for a couple weeks. Once it's ingrained into your schedule and you're maintaining and being consistent, add the next thing and then add the next thing. And that way you're building a foundation towards success instead of failure. So I think that's really, really key. I do think the idea of interval training has to be mentioned just because it is such a hack. If you are wanting to lose weight, interval training is one of the fastest ways there. And I'm going to just explain it very simply. It's periods of high intensity combined with periods of low intensity. Your time amounts for each of those is totally up to you. So if I'm out on a walk, I'll do 30 seconds hard as fast as I can walk and 30 seconds slow as I can walk. Because we all understand that a car on a highway is much easier to sustain than a car turning through different parts of the city and slowing down. And that's what we want our bodies to do. We want our bodies to work harder. So instead of going to the gym and getting on the same elliptical and going for the same 20 minutes, which is what my husband does, and now he's wondering why after 6 months he's not losing any more weight, we need to constantly be surprising our bodies and challenging it with kind of a high, low, high, low. There's lots of information on interval training out there, tons on the website. And so do feel free to dig into that more deeply. I think it's really key. And I think one of the biggest ones, Laura, is stop building your own brick walls. And so using excuses that are flimsy and not servicing you in any way, shape, or form, like I'm embarrassed, I don't want to work out in front of people, I don't like the outfits I have, I'm not sure how to do that. All of those are surmountable excuses and they're keeping you from what you want to achieve. So you've got to get rid of them. That's a real key one. And then finally, back to a little bit of the movement thing is the idea of just making sure you're working, you know, I can remember my dad coming home in the 80s saying, oh, I got to start exercising. The doc wants me to walk, you know, 30 minutes, three times a week. And I thought, oh, okay. But then there was never a change from that. And all the research coming out is saying that we highly underestimated the amount of exercise we need to keep our bodies and brains healthy. And so my goal for people, I tell them right out, I want you doing something an hour a day. And some days that might just be a little walk. Some days that might be a full out workout. Some days it might just be stretching, but something that's moving your body an hour a day. So those are some of the just basic premises to get going on from that standpoint. And just making sure you're moving every joint, every way, every day, and just keep that mantra going that you are doing something that moves your body in as many ranges of motion as possible.
I think that is key. And if there's anything I can add to that, I would say I follow each and every one of those concepts. And in fact, you have so many high intensity interval training videos out there. Sometimes I just watch you do high intensity.
That's awesome.
It's like the 20 minute workout way back in the day. And I would like sit there and people would probably have their morning coffee and watch people do that.
Yeah.
But I definitely, it inspires me because it's a small chunk that you can take in and do, because a high intensity interval training can be 5, 10, 20 minutes.
Yeah.
It doesn't need to be, nor really should it be, extremely long. Gone are the days where you're just going to go, you know, long and slow for hours and hours and hours. So that's a great one. And, you know, this is where our chiropractic background comes into play, is we are playing the long game, right? Life is all about the long game. And when I make a choice right now, it is keeping in mind what I need and what feels good to me in this moment. But more importantly, it's setting me up for success in the future. Listen, if you, and this dovetails into the whole idea of movement and mobility, and what if you get setbacks and you don't have good mobility? That's really what we're trying to make sure. We're trying to make sure that in 20 years or 10 years or 5 years or 30 years, that you can squat down and pick up something off the ground, or get into a low chair, or get out of the car, or, you know, hold up your body weight if you fall down. And, you know, when you're not in that mode, it seems so ridiculous. You're thinking, well, how can I not do that? But I see people editing their lives all the time. Even at 40 years old, they're like, oh, I got a bad back. And then they stop moving the way their body's supposed to move, and they start moving the way they're afraid to move, right? Yeah. Or fear makes them move, might be the better word. So, you know, really, like, these are just such important concepts. We've made all these changes in the detox to help leverage not just how you feel, but how you function. And this is such a big part of it. So,
yeah, and, And one thing I think you've literally just defined functional fitness, mm-hmm. and people need to understand that term and look for it. If they're talking to a trainer or they're going to a new program, the concept of functional fitness, which emphasizes the daily activities that we need now and in our future of lifting, reaching, twisting, squatting, lunging, pulling, pushing. Those are the movements we want to do, getting up and off the toilet, out of a car, reaching for an overhead suitcase. All of those things are important. And if you are not doing them today, you certainly will not be able to do them tomorrow. Somebody I interviewed recently talked about Asian women, 80-year-old Asian women being able to be in a full squat for half an hour with no problem. Wow. It's because they've been doing it every day. That's how they sit and communicate and share with each other. And so they've been practicing it. And so what you do today, if you keep doing it every day, you'll be able to keep doing it. But if you don't, and like you said, you apply this fear avoidance behavior. My favorite is girls in heels walking downstairs, gripping both side rails. You've just let go of any core stimulation at all. And balance is such a big thing for women. We need to be challenging it daily. And so making sure, even just standing on one foot or looking for opportunities to challenge your balance, walk on a beam, you know, on a little piece of the road or whatever, and just work on balance, because I chat with my inner septuagenarian quite a bit. And so what she tells me is that if I want to be traveling and active in the way that I do, then these are the things we have to be doing every day.
100%. And yeah, I get pretty excited about that, because you and I have both seen the difference between the people who take one course and the people who don't. Yeah, so if you're that person that doesn't have great mobility, and this inspires you, and because when people don't have good mobility, they know they don't have good mobility, and they know that there's things they're already striking off the list of what they're capable of.
Yes.
How do we work with those people? Like, what can we give them as sort of some pointers and some objectives for them? What can we do?
I'm just trying to think of the name of, what is her name? The beautiful African American woman who does yoga. And she's probably close to 300 pounds, and she is super famous right now. She actually calls herself the fat femme. I did not want to call her that. Her name is Jessamine. I think I've got it written here somewhere. But the reason I use her as an example, because she has blown the sides off the box of suggesting that if you're overweight, consistent with that is a loss in flexibility, which is just not true. And so the first thing I want to say is, if mobility is an issue for you because you find your weight is heavier or it's getting in the way, just know that you still have great potential to go to a yoga class, to learn some additional stretching, to start getting that mobility back. And so I think that's really important. Now, if the mobility issues are coming from something other than that, like an injury or a lack of use situation, then there's a couple things I recommend. I have seen some incredible physical therapy, personal trainer relationships that absolutely get the most amazing results. So you visit the physical therapist and get an assessment, get a few exercises for home. They dovetail and coordinate with a personal trainer who then takes you through some training exercises safely and builds it up nice and slowly so you can start to regain some of that mobility and strength. So I think that's really, really important as well. As tiny habits, so the idea of when you've been avoiding certain movements for a long time, you start with just a tiny change and practice it every day, and then it becomes a little bit of a habit, and then you can build on that habit. You can start to make it a little bigger and a little bigger. But regaining that flexibility and mobility and strength, it definitely takes time. The older we get, the harder it is. So please, 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 if you have, you know, you and I have both had patients where they're like, oh yeah, I mean, I had frozen shoulder a long time ago, you know, I'll get to it at some point, or I'll, you know, and it's, oh, we both go, ah, because we know every day there are new little adhesions and new limitations that are going to form if you don't address them now. So that's the one scare tactic I'm going to put out today, is just making sure that movement starts happening. Because there is a point, you know, in later decades, where you will be limited in how much you can get back. So that's important, but there's always some improvement you can make. Yeah.
I am constantly in awe and amazed at the capability and the potential of the body. And you know this, I know this. honestly, people do, we do not give ourselves enough credit for what's available to us. It's kind of like what you expect you get. If you believe that as you age, it's a downward spiral in form and function, it will be a downward spiral. If you believe that your body has an innate inborn potential to heal, it can heal. But at the same time, going back to what something you said before, if you know you have a limitation, a mobility limitation in terms of you have an old injury or you have an imbalance that has just laid down such a strong patterning, then invest in those people that are going to help you. Right. So, you know, what are you doing in terms of not just getting the exercises, which are so, so important, but also, you know, working away at with some practitioners who can help you regain a lot of that mobility. It is unbelievable. I mean, you and I both know people who have come in their 80s and 90s, 70s, 60s, you name it. And honestly, I'm not even sure if I can get them where they want to go. And the next thing you know, they're out of their wheelchair. They're off, they're not using their walker. They're, you know, being able to do up their bra strap. They are you know, picking up things they weren't able to do. And in kind of short order, given the, you know, the amount of time. So, you know, I really dislike when I see people limit themselves because I think that we're constantly bombarded with messages that say we are less than we are.
And that it's normal and it's, you know, it's normal. I'm 50. No, it's not. It's common because most of us are sedentary, but it's not normal. Right. And just two things on that. I hope I can remember the second one. The first one is, I'll use the example. I had a guy come in, sprained ankle. I said, well, when was the last time you worked out? And he looks at me like I'm lost. He's like, I have a sprained ankle. I'm like, are your arms broken? Because you can still get yourself to the gym and do some bicep curls, buddy. And so don't, if you have an injury, please, you have lots of other body parts that you could safely exercise. And the added bonus is it keeps that appointment premium in your calendar. And the minute you start missing it, other stuff will fill in. Your schedule is a virus. It will expand. And so unless you protect that area and go do, I don't care if you do finger pushups, go to the gym and do something or go to your yoga class and lie on your mat, you know, whatever it takes. So don't just suddenly give yourself a free ride because you have a particular injury somewhere in your body. So I think that's really key. And I do forget the second one.
I was going to say, did you forget the second one?
It'll come back to me.
You can text me later and I'll put it in the notes.
Yes.
Okay.
Please.
So, you mentioned this, I will say it. I'll put my hand up. I have setbacks. There are times I get off what I know works, or I don't know. We all have excuses. Things happen. I have had in a couple of years ago, I had a really significant injury that took me off course for a bit. I felt like I had to kind of claw myself back on that.
Yeah.
We all have it. So what can you say about that? Because it's not a matter of will it happen. It's a matter of when it'll happen.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. I think the first thing you actually taught me in another class that I took with you, and that is kindness to yourself first and foremost, is literally the data tells us that telling yourself, oh, I can't believe that. I know I'm busy, but I'm not getting anything. Just getting all mad at yourself is not useful or effective at all. So start with kindness. Second thing, I'll use the example of last year I lost my mother to cancer and I went up to visit her and I literally didn't leave for 10 weeks until she passed. We didn't know she was sick. Then suddenly she's sick and I'm sleeping on her floor for 10 weeks taking care of her until she passed. And talk about a disruption to someone's work schedule or workout schedule who is extremely regimented and has very specific things I do every day with my workouts. Well, it all went for you know what. And so first I had to practice kindness for myself because at first I feel guilty. I feel mad. I feel, you know, it's this whole emotional thing. And then it's like, okay, it's a season. It's a season of my life where I'm injured or I'm caretaking for somebody or I have something going on. What can I do now? And so you look at what little 5-minute workouts or little tiny 6-minute jump ropes? Can I fit in so that I'm still moving so that A, I can keep my stress down, keep my brain functioning, still be available for my family and partner, but still be moving my body? So I think that's really, really important. So whatever your setback is, be kind to yourself, have a peace about it, look at it as a challenge, get curious about, well, what can I do to get back faster? And what can I do to kind of work around this injury and get creative? And look at it as a game. I mean, anytime we look at something, a problem that we have as a game, we win. And so I really encourage that a lot. And so I've certainly had the setbacks in my life and just worked around them. And then when the space opens up in your life, you get back to it. But there's a big difference between, being very honest with yourself and knowing when you're allowing a season of your life to be an excuse. So just making sure that you're having those real conversations with yourself about, I had a great woman in my practice. She was a fitness instructor long before I ever got my training certificate. And she did videos with her newborn teaching moms how to do workouts who had newborns, literally using the newborn as the workout. So like this, and she had him perched like on the elliptical while she's working. I mean, it was just such a great example of the boundaries are in your mind. It's those brick walls I was talking about that you erect yourself a lot of times when you're like, oh, I just don't have time. No, CEOs of companies find time to run marathons. So you have time. We'll figure it out and find those short spaces in your life where you can make it work.
It's true. And, I think that we do this to ourselves all the time. And I love that because I always say, you know, you want to be your biggest cheerleader and you want to be kind of like your chief ass kicker. Like you want to have both going on for yourself because you know when you are making excuses, like when you pick your workout partner who is like even worse at it than you are and you're like, we're going to tackle this. And you're like after you go to the gym, you like stop at the pub or whatever, or you go have a frappuccino that's that big or something.
Yes.
You know, and then you do know. And I love that you can be both to yourself.
Yes.
The most loving, kind-hearted spirit that sees you for everything that you already are. Yeah. And yet at the same time lets you toe the line in a way that is constructive, not destructive.
I call it be your own Brené Brown, because Brené is both loving, but honest and authentic and fierce in her feedback, but in a very loving way. And so I think that's, you've identified such a great thing. And that is that, yes, we have to be kind, but we also know ourselves best and know when we are making excuses.
Yeah. And we all do it. So let's finish this off.
Yes.
Give me a couple of your best favorite resources.
Yes. And Jessamine Stanley is Fat Femme Yoga, incredible woman. She's such a powerhouse. If you get the chance to look her up, please do. Okay. Apps, I do love. And there are a few that I think are really helpful for getting started. A lot of complaints clients have is I don't know what to do. Like I get to the gym, I don't know what I'm doing. Or I'm out on a walk and I want to amp it up a little bit. I don't know what to do. So Sworkit, Sworkit, is fantastic. Mm-hmm. If you need an extrinsic motivator, a lot of folks can get that motivation from within, but if you can't, there's an app called Charity Miles where big companies actually sponsor you to exercise and they contribute on your behalf. It's no money out of your pocket, but you sign up for it, you pick your charity and you log your activity miles. And for those just getting started, it's great because even a walk to the mailbox counts. And so that's a really good one, Charity Miles. 7-minute workout is my personal favorite because when you don't have time, you have 7 minutes. I'm sorry, but you do. So 7-minute workout is a fully functional workout, like Dr. Laura and I talked about, no equipment necessary, 7 minutes, different every time. Great, great workout. So those are apps. And then habit linking. So for those getting started, the concept of starting a new habit is sometimes really hard, but if you link it to something you already do every day, like do 10 squats every time you brush your teeth, Every time you get off the toilet, you wash your hands, you're walking down the hallway, it's 5 push-ups. And start to link those habits with things you already do, and then you can start to build on it from there, okay? Put your workout clothes out the night before if you're a morning workouter. I've slept in my workout clothes if I was at risk of going to the gym. I bet when you were training for an Ironman, you slept in your workout clothes.
I just did that the other day.
Because you know what? You feel like a buffoon if you get out of bed and you're sitting there looking at your workout clothes and you're negotiating with yourself not to go. You're like, you're in your clothes. So that's a big one. Also picking some kind of challenge for yourself in the future, a small 5K or a tough mutter if you're at that stage of the game or something along those lines, a little bit ahead of what makes you comfortable, maybe a little outside that comfort zone so that when it comes time for training, you're like, oh, that red X on the calendar where that 5K is looming and it makes you get out and do what you need to do. Yeah, I think non-negotiable appointment is such a big thing.
Yeah.
Once it becomes that for you, it's so much easier because your family starts to understand how much you prioritize it. Your work people start to understand how much you prioritize it. And you stop getting resistance from people once you've made it the most important thing.
Yeah, it's true. Habits, you know, they start very intentional, but they become kind of unconscious or
yes.
You don't have to be as conscious. Now, not to say that it becomes simple, easy all the time.
Right.
But it definitely starts to create some momentum. So
it definitely does. Oh, and may I just end with this? Because that's such a good point that you brought up. People, the data shows us that motivation, you know how we all go, oh, I mean, I need motivation. I'm just not motivated to go. Biochemically, we've actually found that we move, then we get motivated. So it's those first few steps that actually trigger brain cascade of hormones that increase motivation. And so if you are feeling unmotivated, just know that the tiniest little thing that you do as far as movement is going to start to feed that motivation and build it. And so then it'll get that wheel going and going stronger and stronger. So don't wait for it. It's not coming knocking at your door. You got to get up and start the forward motion and then it'll find you.
Perfect. I love that. I have a little book. I put my workout in there. Even if I sit in the car and write it out before I walk in, because I know once I get huffing and puffing, yes, I'm so excited already once I get going that I'm there, but I have been known to negotiate partway through the program. So that's a little something I know about myself.
And that's good.
That's called know thyself. And I know that about myself. And so I have a little red moleskin that I take in and out of the gym. And that's where I keep myself accountable. So I have to tell you, I think this has been as enjoyable for me. And I think that I have even walked away with quite a few things that, you know, I just didn't quite consciously put in my mind like that. So I thank you for that, Dr. Heather. I know that there's tons of content in here, super powerful. So I'm just going to point people back again.
Okay.
To Well Fit and Fed on Facebook. You have a YouTube channel. Of course, you have a blog and a website. And then you have the Change Cave, which is a 12-module program for women mainly.
Mainly over 40. And and just those looking, and all aspects. If you're looking to up your wellness game to a triathlon or you're looking to up your wellness game to get off the couch, the content is there for you.
And the content spans everything, right? Like it spans quite a few things.
Yeah.
And it's go ahead.
I was just going to say, we just finished one on exercise. We've got one on habits and mindfulness coming up. So each month is a different module and we've got a fierce group of Facebook warriors who are all really motivating each other and it's great. So thank you for that.
Well, and I think it's important. And one of the things I'd say is it's a very small buy-in considering what you're getting. What I love about programs like that is what I love about this program is that there is a level of accountability because there is a group dynamic. You have you leading the charge, you have guest experts, but then you have each other. And I cannot think of anything that's more powerful for me and for others. So I love that. So I want people to make sure that they look at that as where they can be going forward from here.
Yeah.
And then of course they can always connect with you on your website, WellFit.
Yes. Okay. Absolutely. And thank you, Laura, for doing what you do. I have learned so much through your programs and I just appreciate the work you do as well. And every one of you out there is very lucky to be involved with this program. So well done.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Heather. And to everyone else, keep going. I always do this. It's the high five and the hug and all the good accolades, because I know this isn't easy. And yeah. I really just want to commend you for all the time and work and dedication and effort and showing up and just all the things that you do to get the results that you're looking for. So yeah. I notice, I see you, and I appreciate that you've joined me. So have a great day, and we'll see you on the next video.